Oh, there we go. Some of y'all know I do this stuff sitting in my house in the comfort of my own home, and that's the way I like it, and that's the way I'm going to do it. As you can tell, I got a little helper back there behind me. Tonight we're going to talk a little bit about history, and it's probably not, you know, all of this stuff is historically recorded, but I don't know that anyone's ever put it in the same order that I have. Life and the Love of Life was a, probably could have titled it better. Life and the Love of Life, Leif and Leif Thrasir are the two individuals that emerged from Yggdrasil after Ragnarok. That is, their names mean life and the love of life. This is a study of how that kind of stuff moves forward. And I'm going to read from Life and the Love of Life and have a little commentary on it, and I hope you enjoy it. We're going to start in the Middle Ages. During those Middle Ages, there were deviations from the norm. We have typically referred to them as a mini Ice Age. Okay, I'm going to talk about a couple of them, which we know about from the recorded history of Europe. See if we can kind of draw a parallel or a pattern there. One of which is a story, it's in the lore. It's actually, you know, in our sagas. One of which is from a story, it's in around 320. A Swedish king, Demalder Visbursen, was sacrificed. And there's a reason for that. And it's an interesting reason. For 3 long years, his kingdom had endured multiple failures of agriculture. 3 years. Famine and his companions became common guests in the villages of his kingdom. Most certainly, death made itself well known in this hard time. And this is not what we refer to as the Middle Ages. This was the Dark Ages. Now see, that council of chieftains came together in response to the hard times the people were facing. They resolved to sacrifice oxen. Now this is a great sacrifice indeed in a country suffering the failure of agriculture and hunger. Now the second year, they sacrificed men, which is an even more powerful sacrifice. You know, it speaks to the desperation of the people that the best efforts of men who could work in the fields might be better employed to entreat the gods on their behalf. In the third year, it was decided at the most crucial of times that the king himself should seek the gods on behalf of his people, and he was sacrificed to this. Following this, the country returned to prosperity, and 200 years later, we find a similar tale, and we also find a reason for it. See, the little Ice Age coolings of the 6th century, between 536 and 544 CE, there is a record of a dramatic atmospheric event which caused severe hardship upon the inhabitants of Northern Europe. Couple that with Saxon invasions and people seeking new resources of their own during this time, and you have a great need for a hero. This information was first given to us as the great Arthurian myths. They were penned in about 830 CE by the monk Nennius, N-E-N-N-I-U-S. He records this legend of King Arthur and the Grail Quest, and it is here, along with Beowulf, that we find evidence of monotheism poisoning the well, so to speak. You see, the Grail Quest was a quest to heal the king and the land, both of which had been suffering. The king had a wound which wouldn't heal, and the land was suffering as well. For weeks at a time, the sun would not shine, clouds covered the sky, crops could not grow, and it was just literally a cold time. A time of hunger and the loss of crops. Famine and weakness befell the kingdom. See, these stories do not become prominent in the written record until over 300 years after they were coined by Nennius. This is the time when the great cathedrals were under construction, and Adam of Bremen had begun his legendary collection of writings. About 1130 to 1280, these stories about Arthurian days were fully fleshed out as stories to cement the transition from wounded pagans to whole and healthy Christians. So there was more than one reason that these tales remained popular. They were committed to paper and they became legend. back to Arthur, though, you see, the land had succumbed to a blight. It had become a wasteland. The feeling that they needed divine intercession was capitalized upon. He was sick and in decline, and the land reflected that. If one were to take an honest look at society, one might be tempted to conclude that it is a wasteland every time you step outside your front door. Be that as it may, men were at the mercy of the environment, and there were no gods stepping forth to change it for them this time. The honor of a king sacrificing himself might have been a thing of the past by now, but it was a perfect time for a king to sell out to the conquering faith. But let's take a look at the environment of that time. There was a dendrochronologist, a guy that studies tree rings. His name was Mike Bailey. He studied the tree rings during this Grail Quest time for about 8 or 10 years around there. He's shown that serious global cooling was occurring, and as a result, tree growth literally stopped. Weeks at a time, the sun was not visible. There were, once again, multiple collapses of harvests. The people were malnourished. The famine set in, people developed weakened immune systems, and the luxuries of the ancient civilization, such as running water, fell by the wayside. As a result, in 542 CE, we see the eruption of disease in the form of the Justinian Plague. There goes a third of Europe. Cold, the collapse of agriculture, and then plague. There's a pattern forming there. It took Europe 300 years to recover from that. The medieval warm period around 900 AD allowed the sea ice to begin to retract and the sea lanes opened again. The peoples of Northern Europe took advantage of this with sailing routes to Greenland, Iceland, Great Britain, and the Americas. Agriculture rebounded with a surplus of food, economies began to strengthen. When a society have lots of food, people increase in height 4 or 5 inches from the Dark Ages. Now there was wealth and the population expanded. After 150 years of warmth, European society began building cathedrals. Thousands of well-trained craftsmen worked on this activity. All of this shows up in a geologic instant. Who organized that? Who trained those craftsmen? This glorious consequence of the expansion of wealth from warmer weather. Christianity took advantage of this unique and very cyclical occurrence and has long been hailed as the savior of Europe, and then it stopped in the early 1300s. At that time was the onset of a little ice age. Once again, we have an agricultural lapse, famine, and finally the Black Plague stripes wiping out another one-third of Europe. The Little Ice Age, the glaciers were as large as they had been since before the Younger Dryas Common Impact. They grew exponentially. It was the same pattern. The sad thing is that when these plagues strike, they affect two parts of a society, the young and the old. The old possess the knowledge of how to train the young. Who knows what very valuable information we may have lost from the devastating effects of plague-ridden Europe? That concept of a society passing down the necessary info which made it great, which allowed it to survive such events, is crucial to everything in this book, Life and the Love of Life. In all of these instances, there is the evidence of a comet changing the atmosphere of the planet. The ancient people referred to these comets and meteorites as hailstones. What your understanding of the rune Hagalaz is about to change. If you consider solar flares, let's see here. Consider solar flares, volcanoes, one begins to see how tenuous our grip to life on this planet might truly be. See, this type of cycle occurred in other areas of the world as well. While everyone is aware of the fall of Rome around 456 AD, few people are cognizant of the fall of Egypt in 1177 or 1186, depending on the archaeologist you speak with. The standard, and that should be BC, the standard line has always been that it was the sea people. But new studies done by Eric Klein in his book 1177 points out that there were several civilizations alongside Egypt which created a world economy. As this trade route was interrupted, there are written records of what happened, a drought which lasted 300 years. There is also evidence of a comet strike near southern modern-day Iraq. The Sea People's invaders were actually refugees. The images you see are not boats full of warriors, they're boats full of families. These boats were filled with families as well as warriors. As the Minoans, Canaanites, Hittites, and many others fell by the wayside, other city-states began to rise. Egypt, though, never truly recovered from that huge influx of refugees they wouldn't incorporate into the society they were coming into. The trade route for tin from Afghanistan and copper from Turkey fell into disuse and wasn't truly recovered until Alexander the Great, 1100 years later. If we go back even further in time to the reign of Akhenaten with his grand vizier Thutmose, who we know as Moses, which means son of, we see in documents literally around the world of a red disk in the sky with 10 tails beaming down at the planet. From China to Egypt, there are written records of a light in the sky brighter than the moon and rivaling the sun. This coincides with the birth of monotheism and when Akhenaten freed a group of people who were Semites and the volcano at Santorini erupted, you have a ready-made case for monotheism to stick, as it were. Such was the birth of Judeo-Christian belief. In the meantime, further north, one great king of Sweden began to gather his copper from Michigan and his tin from Cornwall. This was beautifully written out on a rock from the Bronze Age in Canada at Peterborough. In Serbia, there has been a copper axe head found dated to 7500 BCE. And where do you suppose that material came from? See, it's a world economy indeed. You see, there is a big picture. It is a much bigger picture than we currently imagine. For centuries, mankind has struggled to focus in on this kaleidoscope of information, a whirling pattern of pertinent information from the latest scientific or religious evidence concerning life on Earth. Yet the lens with which this effort has been viewed is of the wrong integrity. It is a grainy and tinted lens forged from the fires of men's egos and the righteous indignation of monotheistic belief. They tell us we needn't even bother to look. The answers to our questions, the remedies for this wholesale loss of our history as a species, is to be found in our mythology. Perhaps the concept is encapsulated in the rune Anzus, our ancestral knowledge. For the follower of Ossetru, Leif and Leifashir are represented as our lore. For us to understand the dynamic information which will shatter the foundations of a world we have largely left behind, it is of the utmost importance that we view it as all people who practice the faiths which make the world around sacred again. We will not survive the future falls of civilizations with this very valuable body of learning intact, or ourselves in the way of life, if we do not. Because the evidence is very powerful that time and again this planet and the peoples on it have had to rebuild from disasters of cosmic proportions. But what if they could not? What if the impact was severe enough that more than one civilization was wiped out and important technology seemingly lost? The common impact of the Younger Dryas provides just such an occurrence, and it does so in the foundation of archaeological thought. At the end of the last glacial maximum, roughly 12,800 years ago, there was a sudden warming, followed by a sudden cooling that threw us right back into a period of glaciation to about 11,300 years ago. All over the Earth, there is evidence of a comet that struck the Laurentide ice sheet. The strike literally wiped out anything which might have existed in six western states of what is now the United States. It caused Lake Bonneville to burst its dam and create the Snake River Canyon. It caused the Veles volcanic crater to fill up and burst its caldera wall. The impact of the Laurentide ice sheet created a tidal wave full of gigantic boulders and water, which swept across the Pacific Northwest. Evidence suggests that this tidal wave of debris, reaching up to 1,250 feet high, the debris trail of boulders as big as houses, have been left there like the ring around an old bathtub. Similar events were occurring in the Dakotas and present-day Minnesota from the same comet. And new evidence from the Woods Hole Oceanic Institute shows that similar amount of fresh water flowed into the Arctic Ocean and disrupted the oceanic warming mechanisms for the planet, the Gulf Stream for one. So it's not just coming one way, it's coming across the United States and it's going into the Arctic north of Canada. The sea levels rose 400 feet, and any evidence of civilization over a 10 million square miles of coastline was eradicated. So any city that was built and prosperous at the mouth of any river on any continent was gone. That's the size of China and Europe combined. Imagine what might be found there. Life became a cheap commodity in the face of such a cosmic event. 35 genera went extinct on a North American continent, including the Clovis culture. At the same time all of this is happening, there are continent-wide wildfires burning everything. And above every Clovis culture site, there is a layer of black mat about that thick that is the ash of this fire, all across the United States. Now I'm going to go out on a limb here like Dr. Gene Squat. If y'all don't know who that is, I highly encourage you to look him up. That was a lunatic. Excuse me. If you consider the Solutrean hypothesis, where it is proposed that Europeans migrated across the North Atlantic, you end up with an archaeological argument that has no real reason to justify that movement of people. The economy might be one. We've got evidence of a world business model, even that far back. But it is much more likely that the Solutrean hypothesis is backwards. It is a group of refugees fleeing a continent-wide destruction on a level we might only see in a movie, hopefully. As some of those people were undoubtedly at sea or on a boat or something, and then made ways to different lands. The only way you can really trace that now is with mitochondrial DNA. And Graham Hancock, who contributed a lot to this, is going to release a book, and I guarantee you it's going to show DNA evidence that says something was the other way than it was proposed. Like I said, most major cities are located at the mouths of rivers. Some of these people would have been out at sea engaging in fishing or sailing of a trade route when these disastrous occurrences reshaped the futures of all men. These are the individuals who would have survived. They would have carried the legends which were most important to them forward in time. Now, I've got a list here and timeline of comet impacts on planet Earth in recent history. And then think about some of these changes I just mentioned. 14,300 years BC, there was a strike. 16,300 years ago, another strike. 14,945 years ago, another strike. 13,600 years ago, another strike. 13,000 years ago, another strike. 12,600 years ago. Another strike 11,600 years ago, another strike 10,300 years ago, another strike 9,800 years ago, another strike 8,800 years ago, another strike 8,200 years ago, another strike 7,000 years ago, another one 6,500 years ago, another one 5,500 years ago, another one 5,000 years ago, another one 4,350 years ago, another one 3,600 years ago. Another one 3,200 years ago, this is the one that resulted in the birth of monotheism. Another one 2,200 years ago. Another one 1,500 years ago. Another one 1,000 years ago. Another one 500 years ago. Twice every year, this planet passes through a body in our solar system that has been responsible for every one of these strikes. We call it the Taurid and the Leonid meteor showers. And we don't know how big the bodies are in those meteor clouds. We just pass through there and look at the sky. Look at the shooting stars. Some of those shooting stars destroy our world. And they do so with alarming regularity. Now, given the volume of these impacts and the catastrophic damage each impact has caused, it may well be time to re-examine the entirety of what we think the rune Hagalaz means, or all of them for that matter. The runes provide us a clue that they are a pattern for negotiating life. Leif and Leifasir are the examples of how we should be in order to use them, separated from the nonsense of this world. But this is not meant in the same misunderstood mindset of deny yourself as promoted in monotheism. Quite the opposite. It means we must build ourselves. Later in the book, I devote 3 chapters to how this is done and how it is not, using 3 different lays from the Prose Edda. See, the deny yourself doesn't mean the physical denying of our bodily functions. What it means is a denial of that idea of who you think you are, that ego, that sense of self that we build up, and in this day and age, we can build that thing to magnificent proportions and not have to lift a finger to do it. And literally, the word for the Chinese characters for Buddha mean no man. There's an ancient correlation of denying that idea of who you are instead of and more central focus on being someone that could survive this kind of tragedy on our planet. Now, I'm going to tie all that together and show how it was recorded in our Voluspa. And here's the part that's going to blow some people's minds. Because everybody's wondering, Brian, you do Ostru stuff. What are you even talking about all that kind of stuff for? Because there's a reason for it, trust me. There are so many diverse bits of information concerning the evolution and movements of mankind around the globe that it becomes almost impossible to make one coherent theory out of it. And see, that everything I just said challenges that proto the pi theory of the Aryans in Persia migrating to Europe and migrating down to India and all everything kind of, and we can trace that back, but we don't take into account the red-headed sea kings or the red-headed mummies in China. I mean, where does all that come from? Were they the original? I mean, who knows? You know, for the longest time, we thought the pyramids were the oldest structure. Then we find a Göbekli Tepe. We find this magnificent monument, fully carved, made by skilled craftsmen, made by men that knew how to do it from building something somewhere else. And where do we find it? Right at the headwaters of the Tigris and the Euphrates River. And it changed everything. And yet, for somebody to suggest something like that, oh, you can't do that. Who are you to say that? You can't do that. I mean, no, you don't have what I mean. You know what I am? I've stepped outside of that societal mainstream that everybody considers normal, and I don't have the blinders on than anybody else does, and I have freedom to look here, and I have freedom to look there, and I have freedom to put two and two together. It's not a hard task. But as I was saying, when looking at the whole of it, one question comes to mind. Why would I even want to? I'm going to take that kind of stuff. The number of academics who have put their professional and accepted image of scholarly importance on the altar of science and summarily sacrificed it is a long one. Some of these ideas seem to be as clear as day. Yet the egos of men who wish to dazzle their colleagues with professional white papers to prove they know how right they are is an ever-present obstacle to creating any kind of clear path to our distant past, or the knowledge they possessed which allowed them to survive countless planet-changing events. That knowledge is at the crux of it all. What might one do if they figured out how to properly utilize the math, the astronomy, and whatever unknown science that allowed ancient men to construct great monuments we cannot recreate today? More dangerous is what kind of mindset might the individual man assume once he realizes he needn't be dependent on someone else for his freedom? Freedom in every level of his being, mental, spiritual, emotional, and physical. So far, the best polytheistic men have been able to accomplish with the pursuit of that knowledge is a shallow, spirituality-based reflection of the scientific one. So we use schools of thought and the sects of faith as tool, and in that division, men are controlled. Yet every day, some aspect of that ancient knowledge emerges as if the gods themselves are leaving us a trail of breadcrumbs. A trail which not only brings the great lessons of the past into reach, but also the knowledge of how to traverse the landscape of the future. A landscape which history suggests is full of landmines, booby traps, and cataclysmic occurrences, any one of which might destroy mankind as effectively as the dinosaurs were. That's kind of interesting. In the Voluspa, we are told of how the world will end. I think it matches up not neatly with the Younger Dryas Comet. Indeed, given the sheer number of these events, it is of no surprise that the Voluspa herself talks of the worlds before, and we begin to understand the importance of gods who have the ability to shape the world around them, on a fire and ice, into something worth living in. Let's look at what the Voluspa says and the chaos of the Younger Dryas Comet. It starts with what could be a reference to the enormous 1,000-foot tsunami which created the Oregon Scablands and many other features created by flooding in the western United States. Fast move the sons of Mem, and fate is heard in the note of the Gjallarhorn. The sons of Mem are the sons of Mimir, the rivers and water features which cascade from the well beneath Yggdrasil. By itself, this happenstance correlation might be dismissed. Everyone has a flood myth, but there is more. Surt fares from the south with the scourge of branches, the son of of the battle god shone from his sword. The crags are sundered, the giant woman sink, and the dead throng hellway and heaven is cloven. All over the U.S. there exists what is referred to as a black mat in the archaeological record, all of it above what we know as the Clovis culture. Now, I am sure there are many other cultures erased as well. This mat is the record of the ash from a continent-wide wildfire which erupted from the impact of the comet on the Laurentide ice sheet. The record of this impact is all over the earth and proven by a number of scientific studies. But in this instance, all I can think of is a being fighting that raging forest fire with an elk-handled implement to protect his home and all he loves. Frey fighting Surtur with an elk horn. So many great legends have been born this way, in this destruction of fire and flood, perhaps millions of an ancient civilization perished. It is entirely possible that no record whatsoever might be recorded in an event of this magnitude. But the stories might travel among men at sea, and distant lands rich in resources would be remembered. As the glaciers retreated, huge resources of copper would have been exposed in northern Michigan. The key ingredient of bronze would become available in abundance. A trade route between this area and Canada with a stop in Cornwall for tin would be established, or perhaps even reestablished. The name of the king in charge of it around 1500 BC is recorded on the Peterborough petroglyph. These people would not typically go somewhere they didn't know existed. Would you get on a boat to sail away to certain death? Hardly. What makes anyone think our ancestors would do it? But there is more in the Voluspa, and it is not vague. The sun turns black, earth sinks in the sea, the hot stars down from heaven are whirled, fierce goes the steam and the life-feeding flame till fire leaps high about heaven herself. Here we have possibly a reference to the comet itself as the hot stars are whirled down from heaven itself. Dust, ash, and smoke would turn the sky black, and the water from the melting of the great ice sheets would raise the sea levels 400 feet. As we have already stated, covering an area of land equal to Europe and China combined, 10 million square miles. The great fires are mentioned again. Interestingly enough, this is all occurring in an area where Kennewick Man was killed 2,000 years later. By itself, all of this information has the potential to provide an archaeological foundation for Austria, which goes well beyond the Viking Age. But the important thing to remember is that occurrences of this magnitude have happened hundreds of times in the last 150,000 years, the entire epoch of man as we know him on Earth. The important thing the Voluspa is telling us is that there have been civilizations before, and Odin is reminding us that if we follow the example of the Aesir, we have what it takes to make it through another such event. It is a cycle, and the sons of gods who make it through become rulers in their own right. And the ending of Voluspa talks about the return. Now do I see the earth anew, rise all green from the waves again, the cataracts fall and the eagle flies, and fish he catches beneath the cliff, the gods of Ithaval meet together. Of the terrible girdler of earth they talk, and the mighty past they call to mind. And the ancient runes of the ruler of gods. In wondrous beauty, once again, shall the golden table stand amid the grass, which the gods had owned in the days of old. The fields unsold bear ripened fruit. All ills grow better, and Balder comes back. Balder and Hoth dwell in Hrope's battle hall, and the mighty gods. We live in an age when you don't have to sow a field to eat like a king of that timeline. You can go to the grocery store or the corner convenience store and get more abundance, if you have the resources, than those kings had during that time. Hrope's Battle Hall, the return of Balder. This is a man becoming something more. There's a huge tale to go with that too, and I've written about it many times. It talks about more fair than the sun, a hall I see, roofed with gold, on Gimli it stands, there shall the righteous rulers dwell, and happiness ever there shall they have. Talks about the mighty lord, the final mighty lord, Balder, the ruler. The great ruler is Balder, the one son who traveled the pathway of the dead, who shed his boyish ways and accepted the path of becoming a man. The guidance of the traveler is something we discuss later in the book. But the peace in Odin's battle hall means it is a time of peace, one much like the time when Asgard was created. How many great empires have we studied to see this happen again and again and again? Rome, Greece, Mongolia, Babylon, the Goths, the Hittites, every single great empire we know of has risen and fell. Hagalaz is much more than just a hailstone from a thunderhead. It is a radical change of the very shape of the world, and from it, empires are created and destroyed. In about 250 BC, there was a lot of small meteorites striking the earth, so much so that the Romans made note of the hailstones that were causing such a problem in the empire. Our lore is the reminder of that cycle, but it is also instruction so that the very important information of our being is not lost through these calamities. That is the spark of this spark of the divine might move forward through time if we have the courage to develop and protect it like the treasure it is. There are lessons in the lore if we only utilize just a part of it. Nature is not the only thing the lore warns us about, nor is it the only thing which prevents men from passing on these stories of old. There is another, just as dangerous concept, which poses a threat to the very important information Leif and Leithrasir represent: the mind of man himself. See, I'm going to start with a pet peeve about most heathens and kind of go from there. We will start with the individual and show how mental imbalances might be capitalized upon and become deadly political systems. Let me explain. Far too often I hear men and women making offerings to the gods, expecting a gift from a gift. I see them make offerings of mead to Tyr so they might enjoy a favorable outcome in court. Well, first of all, this is the wrong god to be making an offering or prayer to for this type of occurrence. Since they read it on the internet, it'll be okay. Tyr was sometimes referred to as the god of the thing, but if you read the lore, it says that Balder and Bragi are the ones that offer favorable judgments. I think Var or Vor as well. Every little group of 5, 10, or 15 people who get together for a backyard barbecue and a few drinks know that the idea of a gift exchange is only a little more involved than prayer, but basically the same. They begin to believe that this is what it's all about. They proceed at breakneck speed to have the biggest backyard get-together of all. They are certain that the folk will grow and they will be famous as messianic ideas fill their dreams. Or perhaps the group won't grow, and they will feel content to feel special and feed their ego as people who really know what's going on without the AFA or any big organization. Everyone else is still enslaved in some manner. They are largely just too unwilling to put their ego in its proper place. There may be some concern about all the negative things they have identified as religion, and they will go to extreme lengths to point them out as reasons why they shouldn't be a part of something. They are quick to make a judgment and give congruent actions the label of dogma. Whoa, can't do that. The dogma thing burns me up. I mean, if you do something, if you are with a group of 15 people and they're all doing the same thing and they're all enjoying an amount of success more than you are, then you have to wonder, what are we talking? I mean, is that a bad thing? I don't know. See, this gives them the self-informed justification for continuing to do it their way. I mean, I can't tell how many people have said, well, you're not going to tell me what to do. Well, shit, man, look at my success, look at your success. If you emulate these actions, you might enjoy something. Oh, no, you can't tell me what to do. You're not the Asa Pope. Okie dokie. These folk usually fall into a trap of their own making, one created by their own thought process. They satisfy their need for spirituality by confusing it with a feeling of righteous indignation. They sow the seeds of their own destruction, loudly proclaiming these ideas on social media to garner similar mindsets and attitudes to their side. Some form of hate or victimhood mentality is at the center of it, but it never occurs to them that out of 7.2 billion people, 1,200 isn't really that good. Certainly not enough to continue this same foolhardy manner. The ego-boosting aspect of conspiracy theories never shines a light on the idea that no one really cares. When I say ego-boosting, by that I mean the prevailing thought process in one whereby a person satisfies his need to feel important by touting the idea to everyone with earshot that he or she knows something that You don't. And there is no risk to being proven wrong, and there is little to no effort needed to feed the mind with a false sense of self-worth. Has anyone here ever seen two or more people who are thoroughly entrenched in such a mindset ever build something which lasts? They swell up like great pimples upon the face of Ossetru and burst, more often across the spectrum of societies which populate the planet. What does this have to do with world-ending catastrophes? Well, just bear with me and let me explain. Isn't that how we have been trained, conditioned, if you will, like Pavlov's dog? If we are good, we will be rewarded. If we are good, mommy and daddy will love us and not be angry. If we are good, our neighbors might like us, and we might be able to get a cup of sugar if we need it. If we are perfect in church, well, we will have the respect of the churchgoers, and the pastor might take notice of our efforts. A careful dance begins within ourselves, and those we might have some control over to make sure people believe we are right in line with the expectations of our society, and we will go to heaven when it's all over. The flip side of this sets us up as rebels, outlaws, and bad guys with an edge of danger to us, probably not welcome in most churches. So when you step back and take a look at the overall picture of things, you find people repeating the same patterns of behaviors which cause so much trouble in their life to begin with. Behaviors which cause them so much trouble in their life they found it necessary to change the spiritual foundation of their very being. Yet now there is an even more zeal to accompany the effort, and perhaps even a small amount of justification. No more guilt. The chains are off and I am free to act as I please. These actions and attitudes might as well be a malignant tumor on our brains, courtesy of monotheism, a leftover remnant of instruction as to how we might operate, and it is certainly not what we find in the lore, or is it? No one would ever associate Sigurth with this scenario, but it is there. As for most folk in their backyard barbecue get-togethers, most people satisfy themselves with the fact that they are in congruence with the descriptions we do have of sacrifice from Caesar and Tacitus, that their ceremonies and offerings of thanks of gratitude, but the truth of the matter may well be enshrouded in the mist of time, like children whistling in the dark to keep the boogeyman away. How have we come so confused? Well, largely because we've got Facebook pages with 100,000 people on them of universalists talking about, it's open for everyone and this is so wonderful. Okay. Many of these people will satisfy themselves with basing their spirituality on unexpected phenomena. They will see signs. Many times a social media meme will suffice. Much like was outlined in the movie Signs, people will look for something to reassure them that they are on the right path. If they remain focused and are capable of moving forward in life in a pleasant manner, this will satisfy them until such time as a truly devastating life situation challenges their belief. Then you will see them look for signs, grasping at straws, and in a lot of pain. Maybe they think the way of faith has failed me again. In reality, these people have failed in their spirituality. How can one not be expected to fail in their efforts to grow when all they've needed to do is share a horn of mead and look for a raven? Or burn some candles and take a bath with sage leaves, rosemary, and lavender? Paganism as a whole has done it to itself. Anything goes and do no harm. Living in a dream world and avoiding any kind of standard determined to exist in a perpetual state of expectant phenomenon. This is why I rigidly believe in the nine noble virtues. When a society I follow those so I don't fall into that boat. I have a standard to live up to and people expect certain things from me. I find that me using those nine noble virtues allows me to put one foot in front of the other and keep raising the bar to help people become something more. Not to be right, but to help people set some of this nonsense aside and really step out on this world and show what we are truly capable of. Now back to the most important part of this. When a society no longer deems it necessary to carry forward the stories of the past, that society is dead. Period. What volume of information do you think has made it through the treacherous annals of history? I have outlined in the previous chapters. More importantly, what volume has survived which might teach us how to navigate the treacherous waters of personal growth? Personal growth necessary to survive the destruction of civilizations and continents. growth necessary to carry some part of the message the gods have left for us on how to develop and assist them in their mission. One which helps us bypass the taught behaviors of righteous indignation or the victim mentality. Tough question, but by and large, our solution as a species in the 20th century has been to subscribe to political ideologies of the saving grace. How then will we best recreate that society we seem to long for, but do not really know what it looks like? Would the value of recreating that society be a benefit to mankind, or would it simply be the best way to sidestep any real work of becoming something better? You would be amazed at how many men and women will jump on a train of thought like this. If it doesn't require them to change much and provides feedback from the crowd which justifies their actions or lack of them, this type of person feels he does not need a sign. They have the power of the mob. What we usually fail to ask ourselves at this intersection is a very important question. Is the adherence to the old idea or political strain of thought all that a man needs to feel he is worthwhile? You bet it is, and it's a lie. Unsure or unable to live in a manner which might result in a favorable life, based upon a positive thought process, there is a group of people who will automatically fall back into the very passionate ideas of political discourse. The more radical, the better. Most of them are convinced that being unable to produce a powerful spiritual expansion in their own life with the materials at hand, we might once again fall back into believing someone else can do it for us. We see a heavy influx of college students within the ranks of Antifa for much the same reason. They are faced with creating a life for themselves and are woefully underqualified for the task at hand, and they know it. So utopian ideals begin to find their traction. When Marx set them the words, it had the same effect on as the Industrial Revolution did as the entrance to three all-powerful female Jotuns enter in Asgard. Why do so many men and women cling to supposedly utopian ideals? People will cling to them with such tenacity that they are willing to enact horrific crimes against any kind of person outside that mindset. Think of all the attacks against individuals by supposedly awesome groups because they no longer buy into the self-serving ideals from any self-named Gothy chieftain or the new fancier titled Dryden. The exact same phenomenon occurs right up on the scale of human existence, be it individuals, neighbors, political parties, races, religions, and countries. Every one of them represents a constantly shifting axis of where they believe our spirituality and or identity should center. Subsequently, it provides people with an identity, a spirituality or government which many believe should provide for them. There is also another reason. Because the mindset of the utopian ideal lends itself to the ego proposition that if I was leading or even had a voice in the failed political ideologies of the past or organization, I would do it different. Oh? What would you do different? What would you do when a fully developed, intelligent, articulate, wealthy individual came up to you and challenged your idea and said they were a false paradigm which has led so many astray? You want to debate Sam Harris or Jordan Peterson? I'm looking forward to doing just that. He exists and succeeds within a system many of us hold a great deal of disdain for, but he has a good life. You can be sure he hasn't wrapped his thought process around hating anything or anyone, only in moving his life forward. While he may be aware of such things operating in the world, they are not his main focus. He would immediately be labeled by us as an outsider. Yet the quality of life may well be immeasurably better than many heathens I've met. This man would be perceived as someone who doesn't really understand what we're trying to do here, someone with an agenda all his own, not congruent with our own. He, like society at large, may well label us as stupid or kooky. Well, maybe you are a little bit out there. Despite the things you know about how the world works, this is a threat to our egos. For the individual, he is a concern, someone to be slandered and doxed, as they say. For a group, the stakes are raised. He might become a boogeyman worth killing, or at the very least, throwing a beat into. So you could be successful, wouldn't he? At this point, it would behoove you to try and understand the concept of group evil as espoused by the actions undertaken in the My Lai massacre. or any of the others which populate history for that matter. Wounded Knee comes to mind as well. And M. Scott Peck writes an astounding outline of the concept in his book A Road Less Traveled. How are you preparing yourself to become worthy of such a leadership position? What does that leadership position have in a communist, socialist, or even a fascist state? Have you mentally prepared yourself to enact heinous crimes against humanity, which might number in the tens of millions, to prove yourself worthwhile to the state? Are you currently ready to surrender the hard-fought freedoms we all enjoy, protecting us from them? Why are we so willing to sacrifice those ideas which were dear to our founding fathers? Well, for all the reasons I just mentioned. Winston Churchill said, and many of the great 20th century psychologists agree with, one of the signs of a great society is the diligence with which it passes culture from one generation to the next. And when one generation fails to pass on the things which are dear to it, that society dies. And in that great gap, that space between fire and ice, the cycle begins anew. Man himself becomes a deterrent to the message from the past of our ancient gods. The most challenging thing about this day and age is the rapidity with which mental and emotional information crosses the planet. It creates confusion, and men will do just about anything to avoid the chaos they instinctively know resides outside the structures of our faith and our society, including the incorporation of radical ideas designed to boost our egos and place us well above the chaos. Passionate arguments and well-thought-out debates based upon biased, self-serving facts become the rule of the day. While we are all raising Cain about it, the ideas we all seem to be in opposition to move forward and into effect. Look at the efforts the Democrats are now taking to impeach Trump and collect our guns and all the other things that, well, they can't do that, and they're doing it. The movies of apocalyptic futures show people with emotional scars and the lone hero surviving the wasteland. You see, this isn't how it's going to work for 90% of us. Don't think so? Look at the people surviving war zones, drought, and famine all over the world. How many of those men and women do you think at one time went to see Road Warrior and felt the same way? Their next thought was after they had lost their children, their mothers and fathers, or any of their family for that matter, to starvation, violence, kidnapping, rape, or disease, was that perhaps their anger could better be suited by being a part of something bigger, or perhaps they could rely upon the government or a great faith. The unspoken threat of this situation in our life is how politicians maintain control of the government. All of these entities reside outside the control of the individual. They were created to control great numbers of people, not liberate them from their failings, politicians and preachers alike might be able to hold off that chaos best. So we allow them control of the herd, and we base it on how much we like, how they dislike the same people we do. It is all an instinctive countermeasure to ward off the threat of pain from this very real threat of chaos. Just ask most of Europe after World War I and World War II. Eastern Europe continued to languish for 60 years after the end of that war, and in some parts it still does. The Slavs, above all, were decimated by the millions, tens of millions, by Germans and Russians. And all these governments consider people to be human cattle. The millions of men and women who were killed in Europe were literally not even able to pass those great stories down to those children. Man as a species is more than capable of destroying the knowledge of his heritage and killing his past. His efforts are every bit the equal of the natural destruction from our own environment. Tidal waves, volcanoes, earthquakes, comets. It is an ever-looming threat. Perhaps that's why socialism and communism drew the numbers of people it did, something to believe in. A would-be barrier to the chaos lurking at the edge of the mind of man whenever he finds himself in new and unexpected territory. A clustering of wills along an untrodden path, but it is not untrodden. The media, politics, and many other entities motivate the attitudes and ideas of our youth and ourselves with nothing more than a threat of just such situations. Are we foolish enough to subscribe to that manipulation even after we have discovered that the religion we believed in was not worth the paper it was written on? Swallow a camel, indeed. I see many thousands of individuals who have not learned their lessons in this regard. When religion fails, we still feel as if maybe a political ideal made manifest might provide the great bulwark against the threat of looming chaos. More importantly, it means that we might not have to do any of the painful work of preparing ourselves for such an occurrence in our life. Sadly, we are already conditioned for it. I've seen men lose family members they loved greatly and go right back to work to forget about the pain of it all. What makes any of us think we won't do the same thing to avoid dealing with the most painful aspects of our lives? Those things no one knows about, but we can't seem to stop thinking about. Women are particularly vulnerable to this, the "you wouldn't really love me if you knew me" syndrome. When a particularly powerful political idea shows up to give us a vent for these wounded ideas in our psyche, people take them. Otherwise, we face a future of suffering for ourselves, which we have created, or madness. It is in this climate of societal pain and indeed madness that we realize the true danger of these political movements and Marxist ideas. Man, in his madness, has the power to literally destroy the world as effectively as any comet. Yet something is still here. As chaos is allowed to reign supreme so long as it provides a positive cash flow, every simple neurosis, conspiracy theory, and radical idea will have a place where it might take root. But in an odd twist of fate, the ones of us who have been labeled as a fringe element of society, we have a feeling that the toehold to a greater future reminds us of its existence. Many years ago, the United States sent a spacecraft into the universe. On it was a golden record encoded with ones and zeros, a digital language which surely anyone might be able to comprehend, especially if they were more advanced than we were. In a similar fashion, I believe the runes were passed through these generational disasters with the same intent. If your house is on fire, what will you grab? Leif and Leifusir are the example of the people from the past brought forward through time, not modern-day people, but ancestors who understand the runes and how they outline the path of life. Those great stories of ours continue to call. They continue to be heard in our hearts and minds if we would just listen. Leif and Leifusir emerged from the tree, so too must life and the love of life emerge from within each one of us. In the first war between the Aesir and Vanir, we have an interesting situation. We have three all-powerful giantesses who entered Asgard. We are told that this is a city of great wealth, with powerful defenders, life and abundance beyond measure. Yet these three women enter with little to no fanfare. One is the love of gold, or gold drink, Golvenk, and one is Hyth, which means shining one, and may be a reference to the destruction in a person's life based on a love of gold. A joy to evil women, bewitching them and moving them with her magic. The other is possibly horse thief, meaning horse thief. Horses stand for teamwork and the ability to accomplish great things. We will see how these characteristics of greed play out for the individual and build up a group identity in the next few chapters. The Prose Edda outlines it as such. They made also a second hall that was a shrine which the goddesses had, and it was a very fair house. Men called it Vingolf. Next, they fashioned a house wherein they placed a forge and made beside a hammer, tongs, and anvil. And by means of all these other tools, they're building society. First thing they do is take care of the women. Then they begin to build a society and begin to produce. By means of these and all other tools. After this, they smithied metal and stone and wood and wrought so abundantly that metal, which is called gold, that they had all their household ware and all dishes of gold. They had abundance beyond belief. And that time is called the Age of Gold, before it was spoiled by the coming of the women, even those who came out of Jotunheim. The love of gold, the bewitching of men's mind by gold, and the horse thief that robs us of teamwork. Right there. The key thing to recognize is that gods are not using the gold to boost the idea of who they are. To them, it is simply a tool, a resource as readily available as timber. And as such, they have an abundance of it. The female Jotuns represent a profound shift in the paradigm of how these beings perceive gold, or at the very least, the threat of a shift, The Volusia records the same scenario here. In their dwellings at peace, they played at tables. Of gold no lack did the gods then know, till thither came up giants' maids three, huge of might out of Jotunheim. And for further clarification, here are the names of two of these beings. The war I remember in the world, when the gods with spears had smitten Goldveg, the love of gold or gold drink. And in the hall of whore they had burned her, three times burned and three times born, often again yet ever she lived. That is not Freya, folks. Hythe they named her, the name of the second one. It means the bewitching one, the shining one, who sought their home, the wide-seeing witch and magic-wise. Minds she bewitched that were moved by her magic. To evil women she was a joy. Pretty clear to me. It is a kingdom where a powerful chieftain hands out armbands from a ring which drops eight more just like it every ninth night. And yet they bind the lover of gold and burn her. Why? Well, if you were in charge, would you want people to begin wanting those things you had accumulated through hard work, conquest, and the planning involved with the thinking process I'm so fond of talking about? Would you want people characterizing your work as the efforts of high-minded blue bloods who have no idea what it means to be at the bottom? Those three giantesses represent an alien thought process of these powerful and successful individuals. They are like a moth to the flame, always wanting, putting forth effort, but always in the wrong direction. It breeds discontent at every turn, just like a communist ideal or a socialist ideal. In the meantime, guess what happens? The Vanir, the simple folk of the earth with treasures of a different sort, begin to ask, why shouldn't worship belong to all, or should it just belong to one group? How does this idea of, hey, I know you built all this, but we feel we ought to be just as important as you are? Great parallel of our society today. Take root in the man. Even down to the janitor who sweeps the floor of the assembly line worker who installs five bolts in whatever process they work on to the ditch digger, all of whom play a role in the success of their endeavors, but every single one of them has agreed to trade their time for someone else's dollars. But this is a painful place for anyone's ego, isn't it? Why, I could run this thing 10 times better than the office does. Instead of going out in the world and trying it on their own, they simply complain and decide to try and take it from someone else. Odin, the chieftain, considers this nonsense and casts the spear over their heads and begins the war to end the communist, socialist, something-for-nothing entitled mindset, and subsequently loses. A war we are in many ways still fighting today. It is the knee-jerk reaction we have seen played out countless times in the 20th century alone. The violent reaction to Marxist ideas, the disdain we typically hold for those who subscribe to socialist or Marxist concepts. It is more common than most people know. It is the threat of loss of a comfort or entitlement which motivates these activists to such ridiculous actions and mindsets. Yet here we are, having learned nothing from the insanity of the last 100 years, unable to identify the culprits as ourselves, and more than willing to sacrifice everything by burning it down or nuking it to put a stop to it, we stand on the threshold of making that bad decision again. Many died in that war. The Shining One, the Love of Gold, and the Horse Thief have worked to ruin a society by encouraging those who have not, or possessed by the idea that they aren't being as valued as much, to take from those who have worked, utilized teamwork, and secured for themselves actual gold, treasures of respect and self-worth based on accomplishment instead of possessions. Uller, the Winter Huntsman, son of Sif, a powerful representation of the country folk, sat on the throne. Yet we never hear that this revolution of the utopian state resulted in great abundance for everyone or any kind of success at all. I find it amazing that this story, perhaps thousands of years old, is as relevant now as it was then. In the end, we find a powerful balance. But we should never forget that free love and abundance, treasures of the sea, Frey and Freya, or the children of Njord, were sent to Asgard as hostages, very powerful in their own right, offering wisdom and counsel. Man, I was on a roll too. Guidance to the high-minded, putting a heart to go with a powerful mind, if you will. That's the lesson of the Aesir and the Vanir coming together. The heart and the mind formed a union and created something wonderful. When we unify our heart and our mind along a singular goal, there's no telling what we can achieve as well. See, it is just as pertinent today as it was then. And when the old stories failed to be carried forward, Marx began his ideas, and Hitler began his counter ideas. And many millions of people died. Hundreds of millions of people in the span of a century died because of lesser men proposing a utopian state and vilifying any group of people who didn't think the way they did. Many of them are brothers in Northern European heritage. It was madness. For 100 years, the Southeast Asians lost even greater numbers of people in pursuit of these utopian states, every single one of which has now failed and or changed its ways from totalitarian ideals. These numbers do not take into account the number of lives lost from just the 1918 Spanish flu epidemic. Pandemic. This flu ran three phases around the world. The second phase killed 100% of the people who caught the flu. China currently has an avian flu, which is terminal for 60% of the people who contract it. Fully 95% of the species accounted for on Earth have gone extinct because of natural disasters and plagues. Even knowing this, mankind is more than ready to end another one. Which brings us to the mindset of the modern man. Cultural revolutions have been the mainstay of human existence since the 1950s. In the midst of that, our gods have seen fit to begin blowing that spark of divinity into a flame. It is a terrible thing to consider that hundreds of millions of people have perished in the last century over political conflicts, sacrificing the ability to carry on those stories and legends which make a society great, with little to no regard for what that truly represents. The ability of our ancestors to carry these ancient tales forward has been seriously hindered, yet our ancient stories remain to remind us of this old cautionary tale against Marxist socialist governments. But what was the solution to end the almost communist revolution in Asgard? Did we see any of the gods toe the party line to support the utopian idea of totalitarian state, where everyone had an equal share of the treasure and worship afforded to Asgard? Nope. There is no example of the development of a god or hero who proposes the utopia of a workers' paradise. What we saw was Odin setting forth into the wilds to sacrifice himself to himself. He rid himself of his ego, what he is today, for what he is supposed to be tomorrow, and he picked up the keys to the universe. He became something more. This mighty and all-powerful being became something even more when he shed himself of his own ideas of how great he was, when he found himself suffering of his own accord and no one around to help. This is when he developed the skill necessary to rule Asgard and the Nine Realms. This is when he solidified a central pole around which our spirituality of today has centered, one which included the best aspects of the Vanir, not because he decided to become a party hack, not because he decided to put a slogan on a piece of paper, attach it to a stick, and raise hell in the streets. He became worthy when he set his thoughts on a course of ascendancy. He did not sidestep the painful catharsis of ruinous aspects of behavior which brought him to these crossroads to begin with, a crossroads every single one of us has come to. The evidence of that fact is that we decided to change the spiritual foundation of our being. Or better yet, to engage in an archaeological discovery of our spiritual heritage. We see a similar tale with Balder and his efforts to become a man worthy of ruling Asgard. The juvenile aspects of himself had to be destroyed. Thus, his death and travels through Helheim, Hermod, Nanna, and many others benefited from this painful transition, including Hodur, who eventually resides with his brother in Hrolf's battle hall, Valhalla. Same thing with Frey when he passed on the sword to the next generation for love. Same thing for Thor when he set aside the hammer and used his mind to protect his family from outside and unwelcome influences. In every instance, we see example after example of these gods becoming what they need to become for what is in front of them. None of them retreat behind party lines and claim greatness simply because they are a seer. They develop and become worthy members with something to contribute. In the opposite manner, We see Loki take off with the idea that he might create a utopia with anger about it. Instead, he gives birth to the monsters which will destroy the world. And when he fails to create anything worthwhile, he sits at the table and tells everyone how wrong they are in their actions, just like the Antifa of today and many other supposedly heathen groups, as well as SJWs, liberal Democrats, and mouthpiece we see talking every night in the news. The true danger and unmistakable symbolism of Loki as the uninspired human intellect is that now men they have the capability to literally destroy the world in a fashion described in the Voluspa. Not with a comet or a volcano or some disease running pandemic around the world, but with two small nuclear weapons, even a war between India and Pakistan. The two smallest nuclear powers would have devastating effects on crops, temperature, mortality around the world, and Pakistan has a faith which requires the destruction of the infidel, and this would certainly do it. Every major city between the U.S. and Russia has at least four nuclear weapons aimed at it. So where is our example for us as individuals to develop into beings whose voices might be heard above the din of lesser individuals? For there has always been the idea that a man or woman who develops the hero's heart and mind might stand up to the oppression of failed states and evil kings and monstrous witches. Isn't that the string of hope left for us by the gods in the fairy tales of Snow White, Beauty and the Beast, Rapunzel, and Cinderella? The greatest acts of selfless courage are inspired by love of our fellow man and the beauty of women. What greatness is to be found in the heart of man whose sole strength might be found in the passion of mob? None. Like a tornado upon society, it destroys without discrimination until it burns itself out like all passions do, leaving the men and women who bought into the ideas with the emotional hangover thrust upon them by lesser men. Look at the videos of presidential candidate Hillary Clinton. Look at the mouthpieces and the SJWs figured out they lost. Fear can be seen in all their faces, along with genuine tears. How could they have been so wrong in their ideas? Everyone was afraid to speak up, lest they be shouted down and ridiculed. But there was one poll which got the election of Trump right, and he was laughed out of countenance. How'd he get it right? He asked people who they thought their neighbors were going to vote for. That's cowardly, I think. But it worked. This is the same lack of courage which allowed men to commit true atrocities against their neighbor. Ask any of the men and women who have spent the last 100 years killing hundreds of millions in righteous acts of depravity just to make sure that they are doing the right thing to support a system of government which could not care if they lived or died. In fact, many of them carried out these tasks to ensure that they would not be next. The dream becomes the nightmare when men sidestep the hard work of developing themselves in favor of a supposed utopian ideal based upon a political calling instead of a spiritual foundation. Theirs is not the hero's welcome or the princess in the tower. Their lot is one of chaos. Similarly, we might ask any of the men and women who have approached others with spiritual concerns only to be refuted and find themselves once again in a spiritual wasteland. Plenty of ideas about gods, but again, what of man? While the examples of the gods might be interpreted in many different ways, with every person proclaiming, I of course know that mine are right, some will do so without even understanding what they are reading, just as long as it doesn't require too much pain or struggle. And there is one tale which explains it as clear as day, how the gods might interact with someone who has potential, but lacks the impetus, courage, or conviction to implement these ideas in life. More importantly, though, he is tasked with carrying the idea of the gods forward through time. That is the Heimlich. And I'm kind of exhausted on that, but that whole book's pretty good, I think. But the whole point of it is that there's a record throughout time of all of these great destructions by both the universe, the planet we live on, and indeed the people that live on that planet. And all of them are every bit as deadly. I mean, I saw the calculation of how many Muslims had killed, how many hundreds of millions of people the Muslim faith had killed. It was like 600 million in history. And then I looked at how many the Christians had killed since the Crusades, and it was like 700 million. I mean, there's a billion people gone right there. Who knows what kind of valuable information about how we're supposed to do this right, about how we're supposed to move forward, about how we're supposed to break out of this cycle of having to pay someone else to live on the planet that we were born on. That we trade our time for someone else's dollars and then come home and give all those dollars to some other company so that we can live in the comfort we want to live in. See, there's a cycle there that's not conducive to man. But there's a flip side to that coin. And the flip side is that now we have the same amount of leisure time as the great noble houses of Europe had for so many centuries to sit and ponder these great spiritual mysteries. Maybe that's what we need to be doing to figure out where we're supposed to be going. If you haven't picked up a copy of Life and the Love of Life, I think you'll truly enjoy it. I continue on for several more chapters and have a fine closing on it. So I thank you all for joining me today. Thank you very much.